Welcome to our program. Folks, you're going to love this program today. We're talking about the important topic, is same-sex marriage a civil right? And Harry, I'm so glad that you're here. I want to pick up this topic today with something that the mayor of San Francisco said about legalizing same-sex marriage. As you remember, in 2004, Mayor Gavin Newsom began giving out marriage license illegally to same-sex couples. And one of the homosexuals who traveled to San Francisco in search of a marriage license explained his rationale by saying, "I'm tired of sitting at the back of the bus." And of course, this was an allusion to the famous story of Rosa Parks. Parks was an African-American woman who one day in 1955 boarded a racially segregated city bus in Montgomery, Alabama. I want you to tell me that story, and then I want to come back to, is it a fair comparison to compare what you and Rosa Parks and others went through in the civil rights movement to what's happening in this proposal for legalizing same-sex marriage?
This question is just infuriating to me. I've been to Montgomery, Alabama, to the Rosa Parks Museum, the whole nine yards. What happened essentially, the end, it was late November actually, of 1955, Rosa Parks, who actually had been trained from a Christian perspective, most people don't really understand that, to carry out a nonviolence campaign. It had been done before in other places, but that day she said, "I'm tired, I'm not going to the back of the bus." And then there was a great need after all the hubbub that happened in the city for the Montgomery Improvement Association to elect a leader. December 5th, 1955, Martin Luther King Jr. became the leader of the Montgomery Improvement Association. They boycotted the bus systems, and it was a really, really intense time. King's life was threatened at least 30 times a day for 30 days. And it was culminated in his house being firebombed. But at the end of that time, King said, "We're going to stand on Christian principles. We're not going to retaliate with violence." It led to the 1964 Civil Rights Act, which included banning discrimination in terms of employment, housing, and public accommodations. And so the difference between that and this gay agenda really is that these people really had a grievance that was tangible. It was very, very real. And I think in some ways there's been a con, I'll say it that way, perpetrated on the American people, in that there's supposed to be a right to marry somewhere in our Constitution. And so what really is their goal is to feel like they're equal with everyone else. And I think that there are other issues that they're struggling with that want make them, I'm talking about gay activists, not all gay people, but the activists, want to have this station of life that I can be married. And they don't care whether it affects the rest of the culture.
Yeah, they usually pose it this way, Harry. How can you claim that denying same-sex marriage is not discriminating against those in the gay community? And in order to, I think, unscramble that, I think we have to go back to what was discrimination at that time, and when the law was passed, what was it based on? What was the difference between race as it was banned in civil rights legislation versus what the gays are talking about? One of the things was that the characteristic had to be inborn. All right, talk about that.
Well, first of all, let me back up real quick. Walter Fauntleroy, who was the ambassador, if you will, of King to Capitol Hill, has worked with us in Washington, D.C. as we fought for marriage. He actually signed on the legal documents that we presented, went to the court cases with us. He says that real civil rights are based on five things. We've already mentioned them somewhat. Education, housing, access to great employment, health care in terms of the sustaining of life, and a fair opportunity in court. It's really no more than that. It's individual liberties so that you're treated as a person relative to everyone else. And I believe that that immutability concept about making a group a protected class is very serious. In my church, I've got people who used to be gay, who now, I mean, one person, has two lovely daughters and is living for Christ. And that immutability can't change it aspect of things is one of the major reasons why there should not be this protection at all.
Yeah, at this point, I think we have to say we feel sympathy and also love for those that all of a sudden have these inclinations for same-sex attraction. Mm-hmm. They honestly don't know how they got there. They just feel different. And then they get involved in the sexual side of this and the attraction to same-sex, and then they think, well, this is the way I am, so therefore I can't change this. Let me give you an illustration of why that's not true. I think we all remember when Anne Heche went together with Ellen DeGeneres.
Yes, we do.
Okay? And the thing is that they swore together in front of the public they were going to get married and that they were going to live till death do us part. And it was touted as the relationship. And they were together for 3 years. But then something happened. Anne Heche went off and married a heterosexual cameraman. Mm-hmm. So you say, now, wait a minute, somebody changed. And in that instance, it was Anne. Yes. All right? Now, that's the thing we're seeing in our churches as well, is that when a person who feels different and doesn't know what to do comes and they start looking what God says is the model that he has made for humanity in terms of human marriage and realizes that we are all part of the fall. Sin that we have committed as the human race, we have all been plunged and it's affected our emotions, it's affected our will, it's affected our bodies. There's no reason to think that in the area of sex that we wouldn't be affected either.